Just a bit of introduction with Mela. She first came to Indonesia in 1984 as a student in EKJ, Institut Kesenian Jakarta, which is an art school in Jakarta. Her father came here as a kind of aerodynamic engineer, came to work with Habibie's project in Bandung. Really about air tunnel, and she came to visit, and she said that, you know, interesting for her. She was already an art student in Holland, of course, and she went to apply for the school in Jakarta. Parents were there, so she got a job, and from there she really hasn't gone back. She's been now in Indonesia for 35 years? Yes, 35 years. I first met her 25 years ago, when I was first exploring contemporary art in Indonesia. In those days, it was really the only place, Jakarta was not the center of the art scene, it was really Jogja, where all the artists were, because the main school was there, and of course Bandung as well. But Jogja was where I started, and I first met her there, and she had this place, gallery called Cemeti. And looking back now, Anuspati was the one who called it an alternative space for alternative art. In those days, there was no gallery, no commercial gallery that I know of, that was showing contemporary art in the late 80s, early 80s. Throughout the years, they've shown some of the stars of Indonesian art now, people like Heri Dono, people like even Masriadi. A whole generation of artists, Eko Nugroho, these are all artists. Some of the works are here, and a lot of the Indonesian artists have shown, really first had their exhibition. Yeah, first had their exhibition at Cemeti. Cemeti is really kind of a space that was started with funding from the Dutch government. Is that right? No.
No,
okay. I will now pass it on. Now that I kind of made the introduction, I will pass the microphone to her, and she'll have a slideshow, and it'll be a very informal chat. So, but again, if you go back to the early 80s, really Indonesian contemporary art was non-existent. Not so much there was no gallery showing them. It was really showing beautiful painting, kind of hotel lobby art. All the galleries were showing that kind of art. So very, very important in the context of Indonesian contemporary art was Cemeti's role. So from there, I will now pass the microphone to you, Mela. Mela Yasma, please give a warm welcome.
Thank you all for being here this afternoon. Thank you, Ilham Museum, Ilham Gallery, Valentijn Willy, for hosting me here. Thank you also for A+, who brought me to Malaysia this time in the Art Expo. I have something to show you, but I'm not going really to talk about those works. It's just some of the artists we worked with, and some of the works on this slideshow you can. It's in our space, but some projects also out of Cemeti. I came to Indonesia in 84, and in that time I met all the artists like Heri Dono, Hedy Hara, Dadang Kristanto. We were all like studying together in the art school in Yogyakarta. But in that time there was not any art space to show their works. And also what happened is that after they graduated, some of them moved to Jakarta to become graphic designers. Some were going to be teachers in high schools or things like that. So it was, or some people went to Bali as well to be part of the tourist art scene in Bali. But there was not any really space to exhibit their works. In the 80s, there were only two main art spaces. One was from the government, the Taman Budaya. So it's like the art council from Yogyakarta. And there was another art space from the newspaper, Kompas newspaper. But actually, if you make an exhibition there, after the exhibition was finished, the contact with the art space also was finished. So there was no space who really sort of brought the artist further in the career. So when I met my partner, Nindicho Adipunomo, and he also studied in the Netherlands. And then after we came back, we decided to create a small space and just see how it goes. So we rented a small house, and then the room, the kamar tamu, the guest space, which is, was only like 4 by 7 meters, we opened up as an art space, and we started to show works of our friends like Eddie Hara, Harry Dono, and so on. And from there on, it took off, actually. And what was important, that we try to show works with the artists were comfortable with, and also what sort of started to show the process. So we asked them to show works on paper, sketches, for example, and yes, the first installations were also, or small objects were started to enter the exhibition space. The first years also we challenged a lot of performances as well, and also asked dancers to do things in the space, musicians. So it became a sort of space for experiment and sort of try out, and really sort of low profile. So that was also very important. So everything could happen in that space. What was important then also in the end of the 80s, beginning of the 90s, then slowly there came some curators from abroad who started to be interested in what was going on in Asia, especially from Japan and from Australia. And then we got another task to do, which was sort of really promote the artist. So we started to document their works, we made slideshows to give presentations to people who really were interested to see what was going on. And then from there on, the first artists were invited to be part of the, for example, the Fukuoka Asia Triennale, the Asia Pacific Triennale in Brisbane, and so on. So that was also a very important part of our work. So not only creating a space for artists to exhibit, but also to create an art hub, a place for communication between the artists, as well as starting with a sort of documentation center.
I mean, from there grew EVA, is that right?
Yes.
So EVA, Indonesian Visual Arts Archive, which is very, I mean, in a vast country like Indonesia, when every exhibition finishes, that's the end of it. So what EVA does is as an offshoot of what they did in Jimiti, was that a separate institution came up, which is the EVA, which now it still exists and documents basically all exhibitions, and now it's separate from there. And even, although Jimiti, I mean, can I just mention, primarily it was not really a commercial guy, so a lot of the work were not what you consider commercial. They had I remember they had a store which I would go to every time.
Stock room.
A storeroom. I would go and rummage through the store, and invariably I'd find something. And they were not pushy. They were the least pushy galleries in you know, they were. You have to ask the price. What's the price? Oh, let me check. And then it would take them hours to find the price and. You know, it was not commercially run. It was not their primary function. Again, they didn't really, because in the other thing with Jogja, of course, it's quite low cost. I mean, it's not expensive place to run a space. So it wasn't really. I mean, but at some point, you did have some grants from the Dutch government. At some point, is that right?
We got a grant to give space to curators. So that was one grant only that we got, yeah. So yeah, in 1995 we started with, in that time it was called Jimiti Art Foundation, which is the foundation related to archiving and documentation. And we set up that foundation, so what is now called Indonesian Visual Art Archive, but we started as the Jimiti Art Foundation. Also with the idea to involve more people, so not only Nidijo and me, but to have more people involved and create a foundation. But we were afraid to put a gallery under the umbrella of the foundation, because we didn't know how it would work, and Nidijo and me, we really invested all our time and money in that in Chimeti, and then suddenly you have a board above you. We didn't know how that would work. So we decided to create two different separate institutions. So we have the Chimeti Gallery, or the Chimeti Art House later, and then the Chimeti Art Foundation. Maybe it's interesting to say that, like, Yogyakarta is really the city in Yogyakarta where artists from all over all the other islands come to study. And yeah, because there's hardly any infrastructure in the other cities or other islands, then all the artists sort of stay in Yogyakarta and they create their own groups, like Jendela Group with artists from Sumatra, or there are some Balinese artist groups. So it's also interesting that in the end it was all growing and growing. So many artists decided to stay after they graduate. So now it's one of the biggest art hubs, maybe in Asia, I would say.
In the context of Indonesia, 250 million people, I mean, there are two main art schools in Indonesia. The primary one is, of course, Yogyakarta, Institut Seni Indonesia, ISI, and then Bandung, which is the technology, Institute of Technology, which is more applied arts. So if you were any good at all in art, if you were a young child in Sumatra with showing a talent for skill, your natural place would be Yogyakarta. And after you graduate, if you go back to Jogja, if you go back to your kampung, you probably be either a teacher or back to being a farmer. So a lot of them stay behind in Jogja. And one of the great things, if you go to Jogja and you've been to Jogja, there's a sense of camaraderie that is nowhere else to be found. There are probably 10, 20,000 artists. You throw a stone, you'll hit an artist, literally. Nowadays, and you know, because everybody's struggling, there's a kind of sense of helping. There's a sense of, and really, there was no galleries until really Chimeti came along. So it's you know, this in that context of a huge country, if you show, and I mean, you know, if you were a parent of a child who was gifted, Jogja is where you end up being. And when you graduate, what do you do when there's no galleries to show your work? And that's why it's so important what Chimeti did was to provide this way. The other thing, of course, it was not all galleries are necessarily commercial. And they're the least commercial galleries I know. Even to this day when you go there, you can't really get a price from them. I have to go into the office and dig in the file, find myself. Often I have to go and find myself because they're not, you know, commercial. But a lot of them do go back to their kampungs and become either teachers. A lot become graphic designers in the advertising world. So a lot of would have been lost without Chimeti being there. I would say quite a lot would not have survived as artists. And really, as Chimeti, as a kind of center, as a hub. You know, foreign curators, foreigners will just, I mean, that's where you end up, as Chimeti. It's a little kind of unassuming little house, and it still is, even though you've moved from your old place in the Kraton. It's still an unassuming, non-air conditioned, very hot. They give you a coffee if you're nice to them. But, you know, that's the nature. It's nothing like the slick galleries you see in the city, and it's still run like that, so that's what makes it special. But I can't emphasize how critical and how important their role is in the context of contemporary Indonesian art.
When we started also, it was in the era of Suharto, so we're under the military regime. So especially after a few years, we really got interested in artists who had some political statement through their works. And of course, most things against the regime. It was just very interesting to work with them, like artists Harsono, Mulyono, and many others, Dandang, Agung Kurniawan. So,
Did you have any problem with the authorities, or did they just ignored you mostly?
Because I also have to organize my visa, and I had to register it myself, so I knew the sort of spies in the police office. So I knew when they come in and having a look what we were doing. But of course, the artists in that time, Yeah, there's a sort of self-censorship, or you know the borderline, how far you can go with expressing any comments on the regime without being caught. So in that sense, what I know in that period of time, only Mulyono, he created an installation in Surabaya about Marcina, one of the labor leaders who got killed, and he made a very specific installation about her. And he had to turn down the exhibition, and I think he did not really turn, had to go to jail, but he, at least the exhibition was closed. Most of the other artists, for example, like Agung Kurniawan, he made a portrait about, he called the Holy Family, which was the Suharto family. And instead of having a realistic portrait, he put a sort of masks on his face. That's what he painted. But everybody knew that it was about the Suharto family. But it's not explicit that you can say, oh yeah, this is Suharto and this is his wife and so on. So artists were just very clever to criticize, to open up a dialogue about what was going on in Indonesia without being caught. That was also part related, for example, with the funding. You never would ask funding from the government to support projects like that, because you didn't want to be associated with the government at all. So, but that's also why we had to be partly commercial, just to cover the costs of the running of this art space, as well as for artists to give them a living. Because of course it was also, they also did not get any subsidy or so on. So we had a stock room and mostly we sold like small drawings mostly drawings, works on paper from the artist. And in the beginning there were only some tourists who really liked the work and bought the works. But then later on also some Indonesian collectors started, or Asian, or museums in, for example, Singapore Art Museum started to collect some more major installations, or in Australia as well. Yeah, so we became a sort of, like when I worked in Cimetti, it's not only about meeting the public, the people who come in and working with the artists, but it's also, especially in the beginning, was very much of a lot of promotion. So our main job in the beginning was really getting the artists on the map, promote them, get them into residencies or studies abroad, or get them into exhibitions abroad. So that was actually a lot, the most work we had to do besides just running the space.
I remember also, one of the things, the very important shows I remember organized by Cimetti was this show called Awas, which translates as Beware. It's a very political show that traveled across the world, I remember. That was really the first contemporary Indonesian exhibition that went international, and really all started by Cimetti. And this is really what put them on the map. People like Haridono and Agus Awage all had work in this show. Can you elaborate on that a bit?
Yes, the Awas exhibition, we created that exhibition in 1999, but we worked with that exhibition with the Cimetti Art Foundation, because we needed funding to get things traveled. So we decided to work with the foundation. And we worked with two foreign curators as well. Actually students from Germany and from Australia who came to study in Indonesia and were interested in the contemporary art. And they helped us also to bring an exhibition traveling through Australia, Japan and Europe. The Awas exhibition was a reflection on the aftermath of Suharto, so of the change from the Suharto regime into the Reformation period. So there were like, I think, only 15 artists, something like that, but the most of the artists who most worked with the political issues during the Suharto time, and they reflected on the last period of Suharto. And we created this exhibition called Awas, which means like, what it means, yeah. That's good, I'm in Malaysia, though. So. And and then it got traveled. It was always interesting to try to bring Indonesian art out, especially in the 90s, especially to Europe, because in that time, especially to the Netherlands, because I'm Dutch, so especially to bring such an exhibition to the Netherlands, I had a hard time to find a space for that, because they did not recognize that there was any like something like contemporary art in Indonesia, and say critical and very interesting art. So they always wanted to interfere in the selection of the artists. But we said no. We created this exhibition, and this is the package that you have to take. So you take it or leave it. But it traveled to the Ludwig Museum, for example, in Germany, not in Köln, but in Aachen. It traveled to Berlin. It traveled to the Hiroshima Art Museum in Japan, and many other spaces. So now we can say that many artists we worked with in Tiemeti, they have a very, how you say, successful career, most of them. Of course, in Tiemeti, because we are now 31 years, we went through many different stages. So Harto resigned. What was interesting to see that what happened is that many, say, of the critical artists then also started to look into the issues of the artists themselves. So suddenly it became a trend to make political works after 2000. And then the artists who always work with related to the regime, they made many works related to the hypocrisy of the artist. So that was very interesting, like Agus Wage, Harsono, Agung, for example, they really started to look into the role of the artist. And in Tiemeti then we started with making many projects related to education. So during Suharto you could you could criticize the government, you could comment on it. But when you have a reformation period, you have to think about what is your role as an artist. And then many artists started to think about how to be part of the changes. And one interesting and important thing is to be part of the education, to bring the issues forward through the artwork, through in sort of education projects. So in that time also we started to do many projects, not in the gallery, but say in the field, like sometimes it was like one playground we made with artists on the outskirts of Indonesia. We did a bamboo project, for example. So we did many, many different things.
Really just confined to visual art. I mean, one of the things I noticed, it was really the multidisciplinary aspect of what Tiemeti was doing. So architects were involved, sound, there was a lot of performances. I mean, music was a very integral part of that scene. And, you know, unlike other galleries where it's just strictly visual, they were already at the stage where they didn't really, art was art, and it didn't really make a distinction between the different art forms. At what point, there was also, we had foreign residences. You had kind of artists come from Holland primarily, who stay 6 months and then do work with local artists. At what point did that happen?
We started with our residency program in 2006, 2007. And that was actually, it came together with the big boom in the art market. And our residency really anticipated to that, because in that period of time, especially the young artists, they really started to make commercial work because the boom was so in the face, so they really wanted to sell. And also what was taught in school was really about being very skillful, but less conceptual and less critical as well. So then we thought, okay, this is so important to create a space for artists to think and go back to themselves instead of just following the demand of the art market as well as the demand of the curators. Because that was also the period that commercial galleries, especially in Jakarta, they hired curators to bring in the sellable artists and sell the works. So this was this whole sort of package. And then also the curators, they set the theme of the production of the exhibition. So the artists sort of, especially the young artists, they just followed the demand of the curator. You could see that was really like a generation of artists, of young artists who were less experimental, making less, how would they say it? Less interesting works, you know. So with the residencies, we gave them 3 months to come into a space think they not necessarily had to create a body of works or what, but it's just very important that they think again what they want to do. They can experiment, they can try new things, they could do something totally different than they did before. And then always after 3 months, then we have a presentation. So it could be a talk, it could be an exhibition, it could be anything they wanted to do. And then we pair them up with, in the first residency project was pairing them up with Dutch artists, because we got also the funding from the Netherlands in that time. So it was specifically more difficult, especially for the Indonesian artists to get the funding, you know. But we only wanted to do the residencies when there were also Indonesian artists involved. So never only the foreigners, but always like the combination of the two. Until now, we still run the residency projects, but we do it in only 2 blocks a year. In that time, like in 2006 to 2012 or something, we had like every 3 months different artists coming in, besides our all regular exhibitions. But we were sort of burned out after a few years with that. So we decided to make blocks of the residencies, and then in between we are doing the exhibition projects.
One of the kind of most disturbing things we're talking about, the boom. I would go to Jogja and visit artists, and one of the most depressing thing you see was when you go to studios of young artists, the only books that they had were auction catalogs. And they were tagged. They were like tagged the leaves, the pages of the painting that sold very well, and they will copy those. And 2 weeks later, there'll be a lorry outside the studio waiting to pick up the paintings to go into auction. I mean, in the boom, the early 2000, 2005, there was a lot of auctions. I mean, every show would sell out before it even opened. I think it was also the time when, now, 10 years after the bust in 2008, a lot of galleries have not survived. A lot of close, and those who remain open to maybe one or two shows a year. The irony is that Chimiti, which was never commercial, God bless them, is they're still there. They survived 35 years. They're still doing shows every month or every, you know, three, four shows a year. So there's a lesson there for all of us galleries that it's not all about the money. And really one of the saddest things I saw was really going to studios and seeing just stacks of auction catalogs. And that's what artists would paint. And that's why it's so important when the idea of the residency, I think, was I remember going there and meeting some of the Dutch artists and other artists, was them working with local artists, where the foreign artists have no idea what is the market in terms of what sells and not sell. So it was just about the process, about the idea itself. So really going back to basic, which is what was important with the residency. If it was just another Indonesian artist, all they will talk about is the market, sadly. I mean, the reality is that they all have to live. So a lot of them kind of really just take the easy way out. Because all of them, remember, this is 250 million people. So if you make it to Jogja, to Isi, you can paint anything. The skill is already there. There's no question all of them can paint and can paint beautifully. It's then what do you do with that skill? And this is where Chimit is important. Yeah, most of the guys will just look at what sells. And they're still around, and they're still doing very important work.
Yeah, and also this idea of painting. So we really challenged all the other things. So one of the first photography exhibitions also happened in Chimeti. Now, luckily, we have MES 56. It's a art hub, especially for photography and video. So, yeah, it's not only about the things we do, but also the things we sort of encourage and inspire other people. And people we worked with, then they set up their own hub. And the nice thing in Yogyakarta is this, that everybody sort of works together. So nowadays, like close to Chimeti, I think there are like 10 other art spaces at the moment. So that's just very interesting. And it also means that the role we had to fulfill like 20 years or 10 years ago already changed nowadays. Shared by other people. Yes, yes, Yeah, so we're very happy with that. And it also means that Timothy can also concentrate on different projects. So for example, at the moment, I already stepped out 3 years ago together with Nindijo, because for us it was always, we had an aim, okay, we have to think about regeneration, young people coming in, but we never had the funding to pay other people to do it. But finally, our staff finally could take over, so I'm very happy with that. And at the moment they concentrate on projects, so it's less on, say, promotional issues, like, okay, this, make a solo show of this artist and promote them, but it's much more on what has the urgency to do. And at the moment, we really challenge exchange projects between artists from the different islands. So not seeing Jogja anymore as the center of Indonesia, but really try also, and especially now it's so much easier with the internet, and also the traveling costs are so much less, that people really can exchange now. So we are doing projects, exchange projects with artists from Madura, from Sulawesi in Palu, with Aceh. So we ask them to come for residencies, and then also also artists from Java will go for residencies to these areas. A part of that you can see in the Jogja Biennale. So this year we worked together with the Jogja Biennale to work on those exchange projects. So I think, yeah, that's always the issue of the whole development. So what to always to rethink about the function of the arts, and then also the urgency. And of course, this is something which is changing from era to era, from every few years, you have to rediscuss those focuses and those. So yeah, it's very interesting what's going on, because of course also each generation brings their own strength and focus and development.
What in your 35 years, what do you think has been the most kind of change in the art scene, the most kind of the obvious change for an outsider? What would you think?
31 years. I think for me the most radical was the art boom, because then suddenly we had some problems with some artists to collaborate, because they were really like going into the commercial thing. And then it was for us also harder to convince artists to work with us, because they just wanted to have exhibition and sell, you know. So, and then before we were really like, oh, I have a show in Jimeti, it's really challenging, and for the artists they really did their utmost to create a very interesting project. But then after that it was just hard. So starting in that time with the residencies also gave us a sort of calmness, okay, we found a new focus, and we go back to the basic of guiding process. So the process, we go back to the process of art instead of the promotional and the selling and so on. Let other people do that. We go back to the things we believe in and that we feel happy with to do. So I think that was for me the biggest. That period of time was the hardest, actually.
It must be quite satisfying for you to kind of realize that after the bust, that they all want to come back and do shows with you again. During the boom, literally, all the successful artists all went and did big shows, overseas galleries and commercial galleries in Jakarta. They didn't have time for you at all. I might remember that, but you know. You're still around, and now if you give them, they all want to have a show with you again now. So, maybe we can take some questions from the audience.
I'm interested to know a bit more about your education programs. How did you approach, what kind of audience did you want to reach with your education programs? Was it the artists themselves, or it's also the public on art and on the artists as well? And another thing was, how do you approach your programming for the space? Did it develop organically, or you actually had a pretty clear idea and what type of artists to attract to your space? And how did you actually sort of consistently get the same artists to come back, or you know, let them go, or how did you sustain that?
Well, first about the education. I think about the education projects, it had very different forms. So, for example, we really started to contact schools to come to see exhibitions. Some projects were also designed by the artists that it was about education. For example, there are images of Museum Chukuru di Meteo. There were four artists we invited from four different generations to do a collaboration project about history, reflect on history. And they created a museum with a fake hero. So they call them Chukuru di Meteo. So, and it was somebody they created who lived through the different eras, so from the colonial time up to Suharto. And because they were really digging into history, they thought it was so important to bring school kids in and make discussions about history. Because during the Suharto era, the history books are actually far from reality in some parts, because just written by the regime, you know. So to re-question history and what was in the history books with school kids, and then the teachers also bringing them in, and then some historians who were guiding the discussions, and then together with the artists, all these kind of things then happen in that space. So I think this is just so important. This is one of the projects, but so it's really a collaboration between the artists. They come up with the ideas, and then they look to work with academics as well, and then we bring in the kids or the students, or depends on the project. Sometimes artists really want to go into schools. So, for example, we had some projects also with school teachers to change the curriculum of the art classes, for example, because the children were only learned to have to paint two mountains. That was the most creative it could get in a school in Indonesia. So we did many, many projects, depending also on the artist and their ability, what to do with kids, for example. So yeah, it had many different forms. And that's also a bit with on your second question, with or what kind of artist. And yeah, I think the programming. I think this is also really because after 30 years, you can look back and you can think, oh yeah, this was this period was that. I think the beginning, the term curator even did not exist yet when we started with Cimetti, you know. The contemporary art also did not exist yet, that term. It was all about the modern art as a sort of contrast about the traditional art and batik, for example. So we really went through all the stages. Suddenly we have the contemporary art gallery. First we were Cimetti modern art gallery, then we were Cimetti contemporary art gallery, then we were Cimetti art house with the idea of opening it up also to other disciplines. And now we are teaming at the Institute for Art and Society, also to make it more wide in the sense that it's not only about exhibitions, but there's so many other things as well. So it really depends on the urgency again. So what is in what era, what time is what that you want to bring forward? So for example, we had a really focus on, for example, young curators. So we set up a young curators forum. So it's also giving them the chance to create exhibitions in the space. And then also we made workshops with more established curators, for example, or bringing them to artist studios and all these kind of things. And then we had the art management curators, art management forum as well. So this is it's all part of the scene, and also to think about how to stimulate the whole scene. So not only the artists, but it's also, yeah, and also the public. So in that sense, also sometimes we there were certain artists that we invited because they were just having this focus of reaching the public. So sometimes we not had any program in the space, but then instead of waiting for the public to come to Cimetti space, we did the space in the public. So yeah, we stimulated all kinds of this kind of projects because we think it's so important. So the last few years we worked with a curator since I stepped out in Indijo. Then we had like we had two indoor curators and they really created a curatorial program. But after 2.5 years also we felt like it's not really working because they bring too much in, they bring much to their own theory inside the space. And it was became too only on discourse and less space for artists to experiment and to try out and to, so they had certain theories and then they selected the artist to fit into their theories instead of opening up to artists to develop what they want, what they need to develop.
Can you tell us a bit more about The Follower?
The Follower, my work.
Yeah.
Okay.
And is it also like one piece in a series or is a single piece?
This is a single piece.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. I will talk a bit about my own work. This work I made in 2002 after we had the Bali bomb. And after that, Indonesia came into the news as the terrorist country, the extremist Muslim country. And I felt like I had to do something with that because I feel like living in Indonesia, it's not an extremist country. So the reality is just very different. So with that work, I just actually wanted to show that everybody living in Indonesia are connected to so many different organizations and are in principle so moderate. So that's why I collected all those emblems. So they are from all kinds of organizations, schools, political parties, punk bands, and so on and so on. So, and it's also the idea that actually we live under this kind of umbrella and we sort of naturally connect to all those different organizations. And these are emblems that were left over from the embroidery shop. So I just visited like maybe 6 or 7 shops. They are all in one street in Yogyakarta. And they create those emblems to sew on the, on their costumes, or how you call it, on their in uniforms. Yeah, and there was even one emblem of Papua Merdeka, like the Papua Freedom Movement, so sort of forbidden as well. So yeah, it's interesting to get all those emblems.
Like when you use the emblems, right, and they belong to certain government departments or organizations, do you have to ask their permission or do you?
No, I just took the leftovers from embroidery shop, and because this just sort of the rejects or the maybe they ordered 20 and they made some extra, you know, and they were still there. So yeah, I think it's a bit too much to go to each organization and ask their permission and. Yeah, because I created also in this whole new, in the new work. So I think it's not nobody going to blame me. Oh, you have my badge. But yeah, you there was Jenny who came here.
It was funny. We had a politician who came to see the show and she found her political party's badge on the thing. She was very excited. In Jogja there's all these specialist shops. I mean, one of the artists here, Eko Nogoho, a lot of his work now is embroidery. So there's a whole industry that's set up around there. So these are actually handmade, and we know, I mean, individually made, it's not made in a huge factory. It's still very much hands-on. So you can go to, we can make different things in Jogja, literally. The police or the school or political party or religious organization will go and order 100 of this for whatever. And you literally, you can, I mean, anywhere you can go and pick up the, I don't think you need any permission on, is that right?
But it also sort of reflects that people, especially in Indonesia, they like to wear uniforms. For example, if you have a wedding, everybody wears the same shirt, or, you know, they love it. And it's also a reality that you
belong to something.
You belong to something, it's true. And then also that you can For example, especially in that time, maybe now it slowly is changing, but for example, you can be Muslim, but you can go to a Catholic school. It's a reality, and I really like, this is one of the strengths, I think, also in Indonesia, you know, you have, so it's also sort of fluid. Yes, and I like that. So nothing is very strict as well, and then, so that's why I created that work. So it's like we're under that umbrella and connecting everything.
You can be a follower of many different things. But your subject could be also, I mean, back to your own practice. I mean, this is probably one of the earliest, or the burqa. But subsequently, you've made burqas, but on very different things. I have one made out of gold cocoons. Very, very beautiful. They look like gold, but actually they are cocoons. And then the other one I have is the buffalo horn. Yeah, so she made a series of this, basically on the idea of, also I think it's a commentary on really women in Central Java. Am I correct in saying that? I mean, the it's essentially worn by women, not always. Yeah, because the one you have in art exposed by men as well, it can be another, yeah. I remember taking her work to Dubai once, yeah, and we had three of these new ones she made based on emblems. And these are all about the what do you call it? Yeah, supplements, muscle supplements. So they, and Viagra and all the kind of, all the badges. But those were commissioned by you specifically, or they, you actually buy them as well.
I buy the packaging and then I brought it to the
embroidery. And then they make it. Yeah. So I got these three women in Dubai to wear this. And they walked around the fair. We got stopped a few times. Like, are they for real? Are they the audience or are they art? So it was, it was in the newspapers, on TV for a while. I remember because in an Arab country, it felt like we were making fun of them. But because it was in the art fair situation, they let us get away with it.
Yeah, my first veil I made out of frog skins. Yes, and
you can drink the soup again, or?
Yeah, that's another work. squid and jamu, and then seaweed. That was the series I made in 2003 after America invaded Iraq, and also when the independent movement in Aceh. Was finished by the militaries from Java. So that was in the same time, sort of invasion. So I made three costumes. One is called the warrior, and one is the feeder and the healer. And yeah, I connected these three with the idea that when you send people for war, it comes like one packet, and it's a sort of weird packet. So you send the warriors, and then you have to feed them again, and you have to give them the medicine again. So it's a very strange package. So that's why I made those three costumes. And then one costume is made from Indonesian military costumes that I took apart and sort of knit it together. And the lower part goes into seaweed, into a miso soup, and the public can eat it. Yeah, and then the second costume is made out of Chinese and Japanese herbal medicine. And it goes into a jamu, and you can eat it to get your strength back. And then the other one is made out of squids and goes into a squid soup. So that's the feeder. In Sydney, I had another work. It was the it's called Rubber Time, in which I rolled people in the one in a mattress and one in a zinc roof top, and one in. Yeah, but there were fake feet also. There was only one laying on the floor, which was real, that was me. And the rest was all fake feet, with it, so everybody was really confused. And that was also the idea, because I got that idea actually, when I had a residency in La Salle, I came one day out of my house where I stayed, and I saw this rolled mattress on the street. And yeah, I thought like, oh my God, is there somebody inside or what? And then I combined it with another thing I saw in Jakarta, in Yogyakarta, also on the car in driving in front of me, where I saw some cardboard boxes and 2 feet sticking out. And it looked like, oh my God, is this person dead or is he alive or is he asleep? So this kind of confusion, what we often experience in if we travel through Asia, I wanted to express in that work. So it's about, yeah, if you don't know if this person is drunk or it's dead or it's asleep or whatever. In Sydney was 2004, yeah. That was 4A, yeah. So yeah, I like to work with coverings and sort of direct contact with the public as well, sort of confronting and inviting at the same time.
And your present work, the one that the, you don't have a picture of it, basically it's again a costume, but it's made out of kind of handbags. Can you explain the handbags? So she basically has all these handbags that are stacked up, and you wear it, and then one of the handbags is actually cut out, so you can actually look through it. So there's three costumes at the art fair now. Can you explain what's the idea behind that?
Yeah, the first one I made in a residency in Los Angeles, and when I was in Los Angeles, I was sort of shocked of so many people living on the street. So yeah, I mean, with all the suitcases. So I really start to think, and also with this, all those issues about the refugees in Europe and everywhere. What is it what you carry when you have to run away, you know? What is it what you select and what is important for you to keep? So I started, and especially when you see all those people, especially in LA, they are sleeping on the street or on the beach, they're having all those plastic bags or any other bags, but so what do they really carry? And this idea of carrying, so then I created that, because there are so many vintage shops also in LA, so I started to collect all those bags and suitcases, and that made a first work out of that. After that, I made the two other costumes, and that was more about the idea of collecting, that people are crazy with collecting their stuff. And then also, yeah, of course, it also relates to bags, because you have to put it in something and to carry it. And so this is the other two series, actually. And I bought one Prada bag. It was sold to me as a real Prada bag. I brought it back to Indonesia to dismantle it with the idea I stick a hat through it. And then we found out it was plastic, actually. So, yes. So I don't know if it's a real Prada bag or it's Prada who is cheating me or...
Well, you didn't buy it in a Prada shop.
No, it was in the second hand, but expensive. And it was really sold. It really looked like real leather as well, so... I bought them, but also in the vintage shops. So there are some really old ones, as you can see, and some, yeah, like some plastic, different materials. But most of them, yeah, they're all secondhand. They all carry their memories also of the ones who carried them around before. Only one bag that I created is the other bag on the head of one of the girls, like. So there's one part of the bag you can open where you can look through it. So the hat is in the bag, yeah. But the Prada bag is the original Prada bag. I mean, original.
Yeah, so the handbag. This is. Yeah, suitcases. She actually, just before we came here, she actually had to put the marble in there.
So yeah, I of course I came as an artist to Indonesia to study art, and then yeah, because there was no other art space, so we set up art space together with my husband, and then of course yeah, you have two roles to fulfill, and I'm actually quite happy now that since 3 years I'm a full-time artist. But on the other hand, it's also inspiring. So it's always, one is always feeding the other. That's also what I always thought. So although sometimes you have to spend a lot of time of working with the other with the Indonesian artist or other artists in Jemeti, but it also inspired me a lot. And yeah, it created a lot of content and discussion, and it's so important, and all these exchanges. So it's part of my life. Maybe more questions? Please.
How do you see the future of specifically a Yogyakartan art in the expansion of different cities now? We have like different festival, like now Indonesia have a Jatim Biennale, I think. So there's so many new places that open up now. So what do you think of the future of Yogyakartan art especially?
I think it still has an important role to fulfill, Yogyakarta, because there's still sort of the place where people come to hang out, to study, and to learn about the latest developments. And also because it's extending with the different hubs again. And so there are many things going on. And then in the meantime, yeah, also now, luckily, finally, it's not only in three cities anymore, because before it was only in Jakarta and in Bandung and in Yogyakarta and on Bali, but Bali is more is an island, so that's a different, it's a different atmosphere anyway. So it's happy now that I'm happy that it's sort of it creates very different many other, say, art organizations, and also it has many different forms as well, which is so interesting. So it's not so much about having a space, like for example Cimetti is really about the space, and then people have to go there. But it's also, of course, now with the internet there are so many different ways of different platforms, and also the mixture of the different disciplines and the exchanges and the way how people communicate so much easier. I think it's just very interesting. On the other hand, sometimes I'm longing for a very strong solo exhibition of an artist, for example, because so many things are happening in community or community-based. But then sometimes I miss the sort of statement that artists make, you know, like sometimes it's a bit easy to be caught in the community, and then it's a bit, how do you say? No, it's not lost, but it's more like, okay, it's just comfortable to be in there, so you don't need to make a statement, you know, or to have your own voice, yeah. So I miss that sometimes, because it's too much in the community. Yeah, it's a Makassar Biennale, yeah.
I think it's a good, it's a healthy thing that, you know, it's no long, I mean, in such a vast country with three time zones, to have the art hub kind of more dispersed. Not everybody can go to Jogja or Jakarta or Bandung. So it's good to have, and Bali now have their own, has a kind of very slick, dedicated art space. And then it's good to see, like, and then there's this ceramic festival also in Jatiwangi. So it is good that I think it's healthy, you know, that it's spread out across this vast archipelago. That not all art springs from the center. It's good to have it out in the provinces and just as relevant, just as important. I think, you know, I think it's a healthy sign. For me, yeah. That's a healthy sign. I think, you know, a lot of that is, you know, because also you use Cimetti as a model. It's really quite low cost. The only thing you need is enthusiasm. You know, and time. So, you know, you don't, like you said, you don't need the space even. You can take over a warehouse or even streets. I mean, you know, I've seen exhibitions under the trees. frankly, it's white boxes can be limiting and oppressive. So, yeah, I don't think, you know, one of the things that if you look at Jakarta is how definition of art and definition of practice have really expanded beyond what you have seen in other countries itself. Yeah, is there any other questions?
I think it also happens in other areas now in Southeast Asia as well. For example, the Petani, for example, now suddenly has also the attention.
In the Philippines, the South.
Yeah, exactly. And I think in Malaysia as well, right?
Yeah. So it's important that, you know, we don't kind of concentrate everything in the center. Obviously, the main commercial capital, the main commercial guys are still in the capital or in the principal cities. But really, art making itself, engagement with artists doesn't have to be focused and centered in the cities. It's secondary cities, smaller cities are just as important, I think. Yeah, I think it's a really good trend. In Philippines, I noticed now that we have ex-con, which is down in Dumaguete, and there's another, so there's a lot of different other venues. And really, it's, you know, people think organizing an art thing is expensive and difficult. It is not. It's not. It's really all it is enthusiasm and a bit of time. You don't even need funding, frankly. I mean, there was in Bangkok, I mean, suddenly there was 3 Biennales last year. 3. One was privately funded by a big beer company. One was the Krabi one, which is a moving Biennale, so it moves from different location, funded by the government. And the third one, called Tananbe, which is entirely artist run. There are different models, and I think that's a healthy sign. Yeah. There's no more question. I'd like you all to give a round of applause to our guest, Mela, and yourself for spending the Sunday afternoon with us. Thank you.